I'm fully aware that in my last video I said a few things about wanting to finish some books by the end of December, but that didn't happen. I apologize for saying this a whole month later, but I hope everyone's having a great 2020. I hope January wasn't too tough on you. I personally have always hated the transition from November to December and then into January. Like that crazy month of December, you know, that crazy period between Christmas and New Year's where you just don't know what day it is. I've always hated that. It's so disorienting, especially since I usually spend those last 2 weeks of December with my family vacationing. So yeah, that's how my end of year was. I got to see the London fireworks from my sister's apartment, so that was really nice. But at the same time, I did not I did not read. I was not reading for like the longest time, recently trying to get back into the grind. And today I'm just going to be talking about the books that I did manage to read. Some books in November that I really liked that I haven't talked about, so I want to take the time to talk about those two, or else I would have no content for this video. So the first book is a poetry book. I read this, started reading it in December, but didn't finish it until beginning of Jan. It's called Menyelamimu by Agung Setiawan. I loved this a lot. His language was a bit on the, I guess, simpler side. Okay, sorry, I wouldn't say simple. With the Indonesian language, it gets very tricky, I feel. My relationship with the Indonesian language, although I am Indonesian, I am not very well versed in the, how do you say this, like heavy literature stuff. So it did take me a while to get through this poetry book because I was having a hard time just trying to digest all the imagery. I rate this a 4. If you're Indonesian, you should definitely pick this up. And then my very kind friend Sophie gave me this book, The People We Hate at the Wedding by Ginder. This book was quite interesting. So when my friend gave it to me, I didn't know it was rated, what, like a 2.8 on Goodreads or something. And as someone who always tries to go on Goodreads first to see the ratings before buying a book, I know this is such bad practice because I should just read the books that call for me, that I find interesting. But that's what I do, that's how I operate. I didn't realize that it was rated below 3 on Goodreads, right? So as I was reading it, I did feel a bit biased. I knew that my friend liked it for the humor mostly, but at the same time, people on Goodreads, like the reviews, a lot of them said that the characters were really unlikable. So the book is written in third person, right? Yes. And in each chapter, it's a different person that becomes the focus. And what I find is that with this kind of book, you would want to care for the character. You want to like them because something that is happening to them in a chapter, while it might have a secondary, tertiary effect on the other characters, if you don't like him or her, it becomes very tiring to just get through that chapter alone. So perhaps the reason a lot of people rated it not very highly was because they didn't like the characters. I didn't either. But what I found interesting was how even if the characters had rotten personalities, they were well written as terrible characters. I guess I just like reading about terrible people. Because not every book has to portray the goodness in people. But obviously, if that's something you want to take away from a book, you would want to pick out something more heartwarming. And I actually quite like the ending. It didn't really give me any closure, but for characters that are unlikable, I felt that they had the ending they deserved. So yeah, I guess what I'm trying to say is that I don't understand why it's not rated slightly higher on Goodreads. Yeah. And the next one is something that I read back in November. It's The Cost of Living by Deborah Levi. Levi or Levy? I don't know. I will find out after this. but oh my goodness, I loved this book. This was my first book of hers. I have Things I Don't Want to Know on my TBR and another novel of hers because this book left such a huge impression on me. I loved her writing and I picked out, it's such a thin book, but I picked out like so many favorite parts. I truly loved it. She gave such real examples, and because she wrote this after a divorce and during that writing period she also lost her mom, it just felt very raw. Like, I know that this book is trying to teach me something about being a woman and writing, but it didn't feel like it was lecturing me. It felt like it was just sharing the ugliest parts of being a woman writer in her case, and being a divorced woman. And what was impressive about it is that all of these things were conveyed in such a concise manner. So yeah, this is definitely a must read. The next one is also another book I read back in November that I loved, 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 and it's Nothing to See Here by Kevin Wilson. So this book is about... oh my god. I'm choked up just thinking about it. So this novel is about a woman, Lillian, and she has a best friend. Has. They haven't really spoken properly in a while. They've always been just exchanging letters. But one day, this friend asked for her help. And when she figured out what it was, so she just, basically she said yes, didn't really know what it was, went to her house, and she found out that she was to take care of her two stepchildren. So on one hand, it was about friendship. And on the other, it was really about found family. I really can't tell what it is about this book that I just truly love. I guess because I really like the protagonist. I love Lillian. I think she's amazing. She's one of those characters that you just can't help but root for because her intention is always in the right place, although the execution is often very messy. One bit that I left, one very important bit, is that these two children that she's to take care of, they catch on fire and nobody knows why. So that is also part of the story that really hits you right where it hurts, because while they try to find solutions for it and while they try to really dig into why this was the case for them, this whole catching fire thing, Lillian really found herself as an enhanced individual in a way. Like, she never saw herself getting married, she never saw herself having kids, but suddenly she has to babysit these two children who catch on fire and she needs to make sure they don't die. This was also my first time reading Kevin Wilson, and the writing is honestly quite impeccable. I love it a lot. It is sharp, it is not very purple prosy. When I picked up this book, I really didn't know what to expect, so I was just very, very pleasantly surprised by all the things that this book offered. So I would highly recommend this if you want to read something that is more family, less fiery romance, although it did have some romance in it, and it has good representation as well. It's just such a delight. Like, if Frankly in Love wasn't my brand yet, I think I would want this book to be my brand. I guess that's it for this video. I feel like I've been crouching the entire time. I'm currently reading I'll Give You the Sun. It's taking me such a long time to get through it, for reasons that I probably will tell you later when I do finish it. So yeah, I hope to see you in the next vid with more books. I need to be reading like one book per week, at least for my goal. But we'll see.